Hello, church. Pastor Travis here. Really excited to do another Revelation teaching. This is part four of the teaching on the book of Revelations, the letters to the seven churches. Again, I want to just start in Revelation chapter one. I love this promise that's given to us so clearly by John. It says here in verse three, "Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near." And I love the book of Revelations because, again, it's not just a historical book showing us dispensational time periods, giving us prophetic encouragement. It also has a lot of really good teaching in preparing our hearts for the coming of the Lord. Very, very powerful book, and blessed is he or she who reads it. So we've been doing our teaching on the seven churches. Today we are on the dead church. And so this is in Revelations chapter 3. Verse 1, and I want to encourage you, if you're listening in, to grab your Bible. I'm reading under the New King James Version, and we're just going to dive into this. So Revelations chapter 3, verse 1, and it says here, "And to the angel of the church of Sardis writes." So he's speaking to the church in Sardis, and he, again, always identifies with the church in the area where they're struggling, the area that they're dealing with. And so he says, "These things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars." So the seven spirits of God, speaking of the sevenfold manifestation of the Holy Spirit that is manifesting through the seven churches. So he's saying, I'm the one, all right? I have the seven spirits, but I also hold the seven stars, which speaks of the seven messengers. So he's basically saying, I'm in charge of the show. It's not you. And look what he says, "I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but that you are dead." In other words, you have the name of being a Christian, but you have no fruit. He says, oh, that's a Christian church, that's a Christian ministry, and you have a name of being a Christian, but really you're dead. There's no relationship. So there's three ways in which to view the letter, any of these letters written to the churches. You can look at it, number one, as a historical letter to the historical church in Sardis. And Sardis, we need to understand, was the capital of an ancient kingdom called Lydia, okay? One of the important cities of the Persian Empire. And Jesus is implying when he's speaking to this historical church that its church members did not finish what they started. They were all about their image without substance. And so, in other words, they have started something but didn't complete it. It's all about their image as a Christian. And some people have that. Well, I'm a Christian. My dad's a Christian. My grandfather was a Christian. But there's no substance. There's no pursuing right living. There's no relationship with the Holy Spirit. There's no prayer life. Okay? And this is what Jesus is speaking to in regards to the historical church in Sardis. Number two, it could represent the different churches throughout history or a personal condition of the believer's heart. You can ask yourself, is my faith about my image or does it have substance? And number three, it can be a dispensational interpretation. And in this case, scholars believe that this church is just prior to the time of the Protestant Reformation, where there was all the corruption in the Catholic Church, and then Martin Luther came in and said, the just shall live by faith, not by indulgences, and he nailed the 91 Theses to the door. So scholars believe that was around that time period where we were talking about. But look what Jesus says here in verse 2. He says, be watchful. You know, it's so important that we're watchful. Strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. There was things that were ready to die in them. How many know that if you take a little spark, you can light a fire, and if you leave that fire long enough, it'll reduce itself back to a tiny little coal? Well, it's our responsibility to flame that coal and add more wood and add more paper and get that fire rekindled. And Jesus is saying here, this relationship you have with me is ready to die. So you need to strengthen it. You need to get that fire going again. He says, I have not found that your works perfect before God. They're not perfect. The word perfect means they're not complete. They're half finished. Verse 3, remember therefore how you have received, how you heard, and hold fast and repent. So in other words, he's saying you have heard the correct way in the past. You have received the gospel correctly in the past. And he's saying, remember therefore what it was like. Hold fast, turn 180 degrees, and repent. Come back into relationship with me. It's not just about your image. It's about the substance. It's about living your life for Christ. Okay? And then he says here, therefore, if you will not watch. So Jesus is giving them a warning. If you will not watch, I will come to you as a thief, and you will not know what hour I come upon you. Now, in this passage of Scripture, many people read this and say, well, this is talking about the second coming of Christ. It's speaking about the rapture. Okay? Now, as a thief, this is not referring to the second coming of Christ. It's referring to judgment. We actually see the same passage if we go back to Revelation chapter 2, verse 5, when Jesus is speaking to the church in Ephesus, which is the loveless church. He says, remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. Repent and do your first work, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place. Now, Jesus is going to come to this church and bring judgment. It doesn't mean he's coming back to as a rapture. He's talking about coming back with judgment. And he's speaking the same thing here to the dead church. He's saying, listen, he says, therefore, if you don't watch, I will come to you as a thief, and you will not know the hour which I come. I'm going to bring justice or judgment. And then he says, for you have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments. And they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments. I will not blot his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and his angels. He who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. This is so important. The simple message to this church, and I don't think we need to spend a lot of time here, is this. Remember, therefore, how you received and heard the truth. Hold fast and repent. And there's just really this encouragement to return back and make sure that it's not just about image, but it's also about substance. It's about relationship. It's about righteousness. It's about walking with God. It's not just about your name as a Christian. And so this is very, very important. And I love it here. He says, you know, he who overcomes will be clothed in white garments. The robe of righteousness will cover you. You will be made right. And so he's calling people to repentance. I love this. I think it's awesome. And we're going to continue this teaching next week. We're going to talk about the faithful church, which is a church in Philadelphia. We're going to look at that one. It's going to be an amazing teaching. So God bless you. Let's finish in prayer. Father, I come before you right now and I ask you, God, that you would shine your light upon our hearts. If there's any of us here who we're just more concerned about our image than the substance, God, I pray that you would stir a hunger in us so that we would be hungry to go out and begin to fan the flame and get the coals going, to strengthen the relationship we have with you, to pray more, to read more, to seek you more. And we thank you, Father, that you're faithful, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.